Okay. Check. Good afternoon. This is standardized test of low temperature insulation we call as STOLI. So this is Takuya Matsumoto, and he is Nathaniel Tracy, J.R. Eisenfreds, and team lead, Samuel Smith, Alexander Walker, and John Davis. So overview of presentations, are we going to explain about the backgrounds of the problems of the project, and we're going to explain about objectives, and we're going to explain about designs in the STOLI apparatus, and we're going to explain about data and the results, and we're going to explain about conclusions, what we achieve, and what's the limitations, and what the conclusions are. And we're going to end with questions. So objectives of the presentations of the projects are trying to find the thermal conductivity of the low temperature pipe insulation. So we don't have the current ASTM standards for the cryogenics pipe insulation. And as we've seen that we have two main standards for the can be achieved on the, our projects. One is can achieve for cryogenics insulation, and another one is pipe insulation. So NASA created the two types of boil calorimetry. One is a cylindrical specimen and flat specimen. Both similarities are using the heat flow equations, mass flow times the enthalpy equations, and then they're using a liquid nitrogen to cool it down until it reaches steady state to boil off and find using this heat flow as an input. And then they're gonna find the thermal conductivity for in either centrifugal direction or axial direction. So the problems are we don't have the current methods to do a standardized test. And if the material structures are complex, we should find the thermal conductivity on each section. For doing that, and we should determine this test. And we also use boil calorimetry that I explained earlier that NASA created has needs to be higher level constructions. That means it needs to have some money, a little money to spend. It also needs, it's a bigger scale, so it's hard to move. It's hard to carry over, so we should make it handy. So the goal of this project is create the best standards, low cost insulated pipe tester for doing that. And then we're gonna measure the insulation materials by finding a new thermal conductivity of the known materials. So we're gonna pass it to Mr. Nathaniel Tracy about design apparatus.
Thanks, Takuya. Alright, so I'll be talking about our STOLI apparatus that we've been designing and working on these past two semesters. As you can see here, this is a simplified schematic of the function of our apparatus. So we essentially dunk it in a cold bath to isolate it from the external environment. We wrap the insulation sample around an internal electrical heat generator, and then we can find the thermal conductivity of the insulation by measuring the radial temperature difference across the insulation from the heat input of the heater by joule-gating in. In our apparatus, we have six RTVs on either side of the insulation sample. So here is the thermal conductivity, how we're finding it. Over here, that's just the textbook definition of finding the cylindrical heat transfer. And we can simplify that to this equation there for since we're only measuring the temperature difference across the insulation. Here is our electrical heat generator. We designed it's using 24 gauge nichrome resistance wire, and we can measure the power input or the heat generated from the power input of our power supply, which is just the voltage across the heater multiplied by the current through it. Here's our insulation samples we looked at for this project. On the right hand side, we have, or left hand side, we have cryogel insulation, and then here we have foam glass, which is a closed cell insulation material. And then we'll be comparing our experimental results with the manufacturer's rated thermal conductivity. That's the thermal conductivity of foam glass. And then we used about 7 layers of aerogel insulation and then 2 layers of Armax, which is just a wall rigid foam board insulation on either side of our test section. And then we dunked our apparatus in the cold bath. For data acquisition, we used a lakeshore current source, a 20-watt power supply, Elanco power supply, and a National Instruments 9205 DAC. And then this is a picture of our RTDs that we used. They're a platinum Inco RTD, which is a resistance temperature detector, and then here's our wiring. Each RTD, we have 8 of them, has 4 wires, and then this is a simplified circuit. We actually have 2 circuits, one for the RTDs with the current source, and one for the heater with the power supply. And we can, the DAC measures the voltage drop across each RTD. And then we also have a shunt resistor previous picture. That's the shunt resistor. We can use that to find the current going through our heater. We also use LabVIEW for writing out our data, and there's also a front panel for just real time that we can observe. And then we also created a computer model using COMSOL Multiphysics, which is a physics simulation software, and we use that to validate our design and to compare against experimental results. So here we have some of the COMSOL data. For our experimental tests, we had a power input of about 3.25, which is between this highlighted section. And we could, with our COMSOL results, we found for foam glass at 0 degrees Celsius, we'd get about a 0.042 thermal conductivity, whereas the rated thermal conductivity is 0.038. So there is some heat loss out in the axial direction, and then this is for the cryogel. And next, Jed will talk about our experimental results.
Thanks, Nathan. So yeah, as Nathan mentioned, I'll be talking about our experimental results. So for our experiment, we had 3 main types of tests. The first was just ambient room temperature, so about 20 degrees Celsius. And so that would just measure the temperature difference between our heater and room temperature. Next, we had an ice bath at 0 degrees Celsius. And then finally, we did a liquid nitrogen test at negative 200 degrees Celsius. So this is our ambient air temperature test with using the cryogel. As you'll notice, all of our tests were at 3.25 watts, or all the tests that I'm presenting today, just to give you continuity between those. We had a temperature difference here of about 30 degrees Celsius. As you'll notice, we got different thermal conductivities for each of our pairs of RTDs. We had one in the center and then two on each end to monitor the gradient across that. The reason for that is, so we expected this, and the reason for that is our equation does not deal with axial heat loss. So our model models basically an infinite pipe. So any axial heat loss is not modeled in that equation, and that gives us that difference. We were able to model this using COMSOL, but we our best attempt at that was to minimize the heat loss using aerogel as an axial insulator. This is our data from the cryogel ice bath. So we got, again, a temperature differential of about 30 degrees. And as you can see, these are two end RTDs kind of monitoring our heat loss in the axial direction. So we still had some at that point. And we got thermal conductivity of about 0.032 on average. That's compared to about 0.018. That's the ideal thermal conductivity for a cryogel. We also did the ice bath test with foam glass, giving us about a 15 degree delta T. And again, we have heat loss in the axial direction as noted by these RTDs. And that gave us a thermal conductivity of about 0.063 as compared to 0.04 for foam glass, that is ideal. Finally, I'm going to talk about our liquid nitrogen test. So, as you'll notice, between about 3,000 and about 5,000 seconds, we had an anomaly. And what we deduced that to be is condensation of air in a chamber, which we considered a possibility and tried to evacuate our chamber using nitrogen gas. But either we were not successful in that, or the nitrogen itself condensed in our chamber. Thus kind of saturating our insulation. You'll see here when we turned on our heater, we only got a temperature difference of about 1 degree Celsius. And we believe that's because our insulation was saturated with liquid, either oxygen or nitrogen. So I'm gonna pass it off to Sam, and he's gonna talk more about our future solutions.
Thank you, Jim. So, as mentioned before, there are a few primary sources of air in our project. Mainly, our end section is leaking heat axially, so our model does not account for that. So, it's too much that we cannot approximate that to be zero. And also, as you saw, we're seeing some air condensation, whether that's oxygen or nitrogen, occurring inside the pipe when we drop it down to liquid nitrogen. And also, the current DAC model is unable to read higher than 10 volts. This would be a problem if we were to do more high power tests, but we did not this year. We didn't think that was necessary. So here's some parts of our system that we've validated to be successful and that we know work. Our RTDs correctly measure the temperature difference. Our analyzers, both Excel and Python, both are in agreement when we convert resistance to temperature. Our heater provides a consistent temperature profile along the test section. And our pipe immersion technique provides a very stable temperature bath for our apparatus. And our COMSOL results reveal where we can improve and how far we can improve with our designs. And lastly, our thermal conductivity can be accurately calculated. It's just not taking into account the axial heat loss. We're assuming too much heat is going through the radial section when we calculate that. So some future work that needs to be put into this would be guard heaters to eliminate the temperature gradient. We didn't implement those because they would be too complex for this year. And that concept would be needed to be evaluated. In addition, a vapor seal might prevent air condensation inside the pipe when we drop it to cryogenic temperatures. And an alternative method to read heater voltages would help if you want to do high power testing. And of course, both low and high power tests. And lastly, some acknowledgments. We'd like to thank Dr. Demko for his foundation and inspiration in this project. We'd like to thank Mr. and Mrs. Heim for their generous donation to our project. We'd like to thank Aspen Aerogels. They donated our cryogel sample that we used. WW Metal Products. They donated some materials and facilities that we used. Madeline Lane for the logo design. Dr. Reynolds for the initial lab view work. Dr. Barnett for his help in Python programming. And of course, Turner University for hosting the project. Just some background references. And any questions?
So you mentioned that you can accurately calculate thermal conductivity. Do you have any benchmarking data or ways that you can compare what you measured to the data that's known? Did you share that?
Yes. Yes, we do.
So one of the initial slides, we were comparing against the manufacturer specifications for foam glass and the cryogel. There's that one slide is the plot of temperature versus the thermal conductivity, since the thermal conductivity is a function of temperature, or it's dependent on temperature. So at about 100 degrees, or zero, it should, for foam glass, we should be reading about 0.0384 thermal conductivity. I think we were getting
0.06.
So that's about 50% off from the manufacturer's rating.
So I guess I don't understand. 50% different.
So our method is accurate in calculating it. It's just we're having, if you change the amount of heat that is going through the radial section, then we get an accurate result. It's just too much is leaking out the axial ends, and so it's assuming too much is going through there in our calculation.
So if you update your model assumptions to use the console data,
yes,
do you get accurate agreement?
So the console, let's see, is actually getting close to the manufacturer specifications, but our experimental data wasn't. So for foam glass, at 0 degrees Celsius, we would be fine, about 3.25 heat input, we would find or measure a thermal conductivity of about, for cryogel, it would be about 0.019 for our console results. The actual is this, the rated thermal conductivity is about 0.016, and that's about 20% off.
Question, the suspected condensation, how do others, I assume space applications see very low temperatures, have the same risk. How do others avoid this? What's some of the tips and tricks and techniques that you might employ, or what have others done in similar circumstances?
So at the beginning, we showed a picture of some current methods. We use foil off calorimetry. So those systems have the liquid nitrogen here in sealed areas. Also, there's a vacuum around it. And the test sample, there you can see, has heat flow on the outside instead of on the inside. So you've got really no area for condensation to occur inside that. It's separated from the liquid nitrogen. It's separated with a vacuum wall. So whereas our pipe, it's at atmospheric pressure. There's air gaps inside of our pipe. So what we believe we saw was attached to the end where the wires come out. There's airflow, and we tried to do it with nitrogen flow, But as that reached the same temperature as the liquid nitrogen on the outside, the very end there started to condense. So maybe not throughout the whole pipe, but it wasn't sealed, so it was starting to condense on that end.
Is there anything that can be done with the geometry of the test setup to counteract or improve the axial heat losses as a percentage of the radial loss, which is what you're trying to measure?
Geometry-wise, possibly. However, one of the goals for our project was to use standardized pipes. So our outer and inner pipes, those are standard pipe sizes as opposed to laboratory maybe pipe sizes. So these would be used in the field and applications. And we didn't want to deviate from those. So that's one of our goals. So with geometry, maybe not, but guard heaters that I mentioned, those have a heat flow on the outside ends of the axial section, which creates no temperature gradients, ideally. And therefore, there can be no heat transfer axially. It would just, the heat we put into the test section would just exit radially. And therefore, we would get our best results. Does that help answer your question?
Would you gain anything by making a longer pipe?
Yes, most definitely.
So are you constrained in that dimension for some reason?
It's more expensive.
Well, yeah.
The liquid nitrogen boil off we had was already very expensive. The liquid nitrogen boil off we had was already
expensive. Driving cost.
Yes. Also, stainless steel isn't cheap.
Yeah. The cost of the liquid nitrogen accounted for almost half of the entirety of what we spent. The cost for that one test.
So how does your current per unit test cost compare to the incumbent solution?
Per unit test cost?
I mean, is it like a factor of 100 or?
We actually don't know how much NASA systems cost.
Okay.
But they include vacuum chambers, which for us to build was a little bit difficult. Do you want to talk about the finances for 100?
Yeah, I can. And don't quote me on this, but I believe when we were researching methods in the first semester, we actually found that the chambers they use are upwards of like $200,000, you know, which is, and they're going to be using more liquid nitrogen than us and all sorts of stuff like that. So, yeah, probably a factor of 100 less. But as for finances, oh, that's from last semester. Those are the fall finances. All right, so our final budget, we wound up spending almost, let's see, sorry, here it is. We wound up spending $760, and out of that, $367 was from the liquid nitrogen. So that greatly, that's part of the reason why a longer pipe would constrain us. And like you said, stainless steel is extremely expensive. We were lucky enough to get most of the stainless that we used donated, but that would greatly increase cost factors for our project.
So, and the reason I'm asking is, like, who do you see as the customer for this? And is cost actually, so if NASA's the customer, then I'm not convinced that.
No,
NASA's
so, sorry. So the key customer for this would be insulation manufacturers.
Okay.
Basically, as a test to validate their insulation, maybe per batch, like figure out, you know, consistency of, you know, it's to create a standard so that someone can say, our insulation has been tested at random. This is how it's been proven. Did you have another question back there?
I did. I think I got sold. I was scared for a minute. When you vaporize all this liquid nitrogen,
mm-hmm.
you get gaseous nitrogen.
Yep.
Isn't bad. When it's a lack of oxygen, it becomes scary.
Yep.
How do you mitigate this?
So for our test, and kind of a standard practice is to just have, you know, a good amount of airflow in between your laboratory and, you know, just the outside ambient atmosphere. So we set up a basically an open system. So we opened our doors, had fans going to evacuate any excess nitrogen that we accumulated. And then back there.
For the RTDs, did you use the linear coefficient or all three coefficients?
Hey, I have a couple of quick questions. One is, did you do any testing with the heater turned off to see how much variance you got between the RTD readings at the various temperatures with no heat being supplied? And then the other question I had was, when I looked at the shape of your foam glass sample, it's kind of triangular. Wouldn't there be azimuthal conduction because of the shape?
Yes, so addressing your first question.
The triangle is a spork, right?
Yeah,
that's not the shape of the.
Yes. Addressing the first question, our initial tests are. The triangle, triangular piece there is actually, it's G10, but it's just to ensure that the heater in the center is equidistant from all the sides of the outer pipe, just to make sure that we didn't have compression or anything on any of our insulation, and to avoid it in that direction. And then if you go to the slide before that, Sam. So that's what we were attempting to do with our liquid nitrogen test, and as you can see, they all approach the same temperature, and we reach steady state with that before we turn the heaters on. The problem, we didn't have a problem with this method until we tested with liquid nitrogen, when we couldn't heat our apparatus up again enough because of the saturation. But yes, we've extensively tested our sensors to make sure they're all reading the same temperature. With various ice bath tests and liquid nitrogen tests.
You did a calibration before you put them on, right?
Yep, that's correct.
They were all within the rated 0.1% specification.
What's the tub or the vessel that you use to hold this? I saw there was a liquid trash bag, which is an alien solution that works. But what's behind that that doesn't freeze and crack?
So we have an insulated box that we built. It's just a wooden box with Armax insulation on it. And then we have a tarp and several layers of plastic sheeting just to ensure that there was no liquid nitrogen leaking.
That's based on the Department of Energy laboratory design.
Other questions?
We have time for one more, if there is one. All right, you're off the hook.
All right.